Hi, welcome to PN Recapped Mystery. Today we explain the movie called The Last House on the Left. Beware of spoilers, watch out and take care, and I hope you enjoy the video. The film begins at night in the middle of the forest. Cops Morton and Giles take a dangerous criminal named John Krug to prison. Krug asks her to stop so he can piss, but they refuses. The car stopped at a level crossing as the train passed. Suddenly a truck collided with the car. Two masked men got out of the truck and drove to the car. These people become Krug's younger brother Francis and Krug's girlfriend Sadie. Giles, who was very bloody, was still alive, so Sadie shot him in the head. Then he released Krug and kissed him. Krug asked Francis about his son and he said he was fine. Morton is still alive, even though he is seriously injured. Krug hugs him with a belt and everyone wonders what Morton thinks when he dies. Francis stole money from Morton's purse, even though blood flowed from it. Krug photographed Morton and his two little daughters and said Morton asked him what he would never see again. Krug finishes Morton off. Elsewhere, 17-year-old Mari Collingwood swims in a pool while her mother sees Emma. After Mari swims, she asks her mother what time she has. Emma said it didn't matter, and said she should start their vacation. Emma picks up her husband, Dr. John Collingwood, in the hospital after surgery. The Collingswood travel to the woods to spend the summer holidays at their home. Mari, who was driving, came across a branch off the road that said road ends in the lake. She turned left and said how funny the sign was. The family came home and began unpacking. Mari decided to stay in the guest house that is a little walk away from the house. Mari was found to have an older brother named Ben, who died last year. It is clear that his parents have not yet risen from his death. Mari went to the boathouse and immediately bathed in the lake. Then she changed and put on the necklace Ben had given her. Emma's brother, who recently stayed home, left Emma and John a bottle of wine as a token of gratitude. When John tried to fix the broken microwave, Mari asked her parents if she could borrow the car. She wanted to go to a nearby town to visit her friend Paige. Emma thinks they could have a great family dinner together, even though John gives Mari the keys and a bundle of money so she can have fun in town. Emma just asked Mari to call her when she got to town. John and Emma plan to have a nice, quiet and romantic dinner together. Mari is with Paige as she works in a general store. As they catch up and talks about their plans to get up, a teenager named Justin collects a lot of junk food. He came to the counter and asked for a cigarette. Paige wants to check her ID, so Justin makes a compromise. If he lets her buy cigarettes, he'll give her primo weed that he has in his motel room. Paige agreeing to the deal. Justin was nervous to see that there was blood on some of the money, but he saw a clean sheet. Mari took them all to the motel. Justin and Paige got out of the car, telling Mari that they'll be back in a couple of minutes. As she waited in the car, Mari saw that her cell phone had no signal. She was shocked by the maid, who asked him if she had locked the key in the room. Tired of waiting, Mari enters the room to find that Justin and Paige are smoking. She was a little convinced they didn't get her, but she sat down and smoked with them. Emma called Mari, afraid she didn't call when she arrived in town. Mari assured him that everything was fine. As the call began, Emma warned Mari that a storm was approaching. Mari says that she'll spend the night at Paige's house and hangs up. When getting high, Paige danced on the bed. Mari asks Justin about his family. He says that they have to keep moving because of his father and uncle. He said his mother was dead. Mari tells him that her brother is dead. Paige wants to change the subject to something more fun, and says Justin could have been nice if he didn't have a scary look. Justin wears his uncle's shirt while she and Mari give him a makeover. Suddenly, Krug, Francis and Sadie appear in the motel. Sadie immediately took off her shirt and walked without a top, looking for a bra and clean clothes to wear. Francis saw that Justin was wearing a shirt, but he put it on. When Krug saw the two teenage girls, he was angry with Justin and told him not to take anyone to the motel room. Justin tells Krug he didn't know he was coming back soon, and he said he thought he could get rid of weed. Krug wants Justin to stop thinking about his own needs and slaps him in the stomach. He throws a newspaper at Justin and shows him that his escape is already on the news. On paper are photos of Krug and Sadie from the camera in a police car. Krug looked at the girls and asked what to do with them. Mari and Paige promised not to say anything. Francis grabbed Paige from behind and pulled out a knife. Mari gives Sadie the keys to her car, hoping he won't hurt her. Krug apologizes, but he just doesn't risk leaving them. Paige breaks free from Francis and went to the bathroom. She tried to use his phone, but had no signal. She goes to the window where she saw a police car in the parking lot. She tried to get their attention, but they didn't see her. Francis breaks the door and throws Paige down from the window, smashing her head against the sink in the process. Then he breaks her phone. Krug forces Justin to look at Mari and tells him that he is responsible for their problem. The gang and the girls were driving Mari's car. Francis holds on to Paige, Sadie holds on to Mari, and Krug rides with Justin in the front seat. They cross another police car down the road and the girls tried to get their attention, but both were held down. They drive around the forest and approach the fork in the road. Krug saw Francis on the map to see where the main road was. Mari tells them it's on the left, so Krug turns left. Krug and Sadie praise Mari for being friendly and polite. Mari saw Carr's cigarette lighter right in front of her. With a quiet movement, she pushes the lighter in with her foot while acting calm. She saw them passing the street where his house was. When the lighter was ready, she took it out and burned Sadie's forehead, leaving a small trail of burns. Paige fights Francis while Krug tries to calm everyone down. Mari opened the door and tried to jump, but Sadie stopped her. Krug lost control over the car, causing them to crash with two trees. Injured, Paige gets out of the car and tries to free Mari, but Krug hits her on the ground. Francis found a broken nose during the accident. He vented his anger on the girls, he kicked them. Sadie, pissed that she's going to be scarred for life, slapped Mari. Mari tries to get Justin to help, but he only looks helpless, too scared to do anything. Paige and Mari try to escape by running to the forest again. Krug grabs Mari before he can run far. He orders Sadie and Francis to bring Paige back. Paige entered the forest and managed to hide from them. Eventually, she arrived at the construction site and called for help. They could not hear him because of the loud working machines. She tried to get closer, but Sadie confronted her. Paige kicked Sadie and tried to run again, but Francis stopped. He grabs his gun and is ready to kill her there, but Sadie says Krug wants her back alive. Sadie tore Paige's shirt apart and uses it to tie her hands. They return to Krug, Justin, and Mari. Krug says it's time for Justin to become a man, and asks him which girl he wants. Justin refuses, so Krug grabs him and forces him to touch Mari. Paige called Krug pathetic, which surprised him. He walked over to Paige, lifts her up, and stabbed her in the stomach with a knife. Francis grabbed her from behind and stabbed her in the back. Krug then stabs Paige again in the stomach. He lets Mari hold Paige, who is having trouble breathing. Krug wants Mari to lie to Paige and telling her that everything's going to be all right. Mari refused. Krug throws Mari on the ground. Sadie took off Marie's shorts and helped her cuddle. Krug then removed Mari's panties and raped her. Mari cried out in pain and saw that Paige was dead. She asks Justin to help her, but he doesn't. During the rape, Krug tore Marissa's necklace and threw it at Justin, who puts it into his pocket. After Krug finishes, Mari puts her panties back on, degraded. Some even regretted what they had done for a while. Krug tells Justin that he really misses Mari, who says that she has to swim. Mari grabbed a stone, punched Krug in the head, and ran. Krug tried to shoot him, but missed. Mari went to the lake and swam away. Krug continued to shoot her, but keeps missing. Krug can eventually shoot Mari in the back, causing her to stop in the lake and she sinks underwater. The storm came and the gang left. Krug forces Justin to walk with them. As they walked through the forest, the four of them wind up on the road leading to the Collingwoods. Emma and John had just finished eating when they heard a knock on the front door. They open and find Krug, Justin, Francis and Sadie wet in the rain. Krug claimed to be a family whose car broke down and asks help from Collingwoods. They welcomed them inside, and John snaps Francis's nose back into shape. Emma makes coffee for everyone and hot chocolate for Justin. Krug said that despite the car problem, they were lucky to crash into their house. Krug asked if they could take them to town, but the Collingwood said their daughter had a car. Krug asks her to use their phone to call a trailer or taxi, but John doubts that anyone is going to come for them during the storm. As John stitches up Francis's nose, the storm caused a power outage. John goes to run a backup generator for the house and leaves Emma alone with the guests. She asked them what they were doing there because she had never seen them before. Francis is ready to use his knife to kill him, but Krug says his father bring them to the lake to fish. He hopes to spend some quality time with his son Justin, who is silent. Francis put down the knife and John turned on the generator. John went back inside and sewed Francis's nose, during which Francis was attracted to Emma. They all went to the living room, where John warmed them by the fireplace. Justin asked to use the bathroom. Emma told him where it was, and he went to the kitchen to put down his cup. He was shocked to see a picture of Mari on the fridge. Emma came and said that Mari was her daughter. Justin fell to the floor. He said he was sick and hurried to the bathroom. He locked the door and pulled out Mari's chain. Krug knocked on the door and said Emma was worried about him. He tells Justin to combine his movements and look normal for the Collingwoods. At that moment, we saw seriously injured Mari making her way to the boathouse and then crawling out of the lake. John advised his guests to stay overnight and said they could stay outside in the guest house. Justin returned to the kitchen and put Mari's necklace around his cup. Krug tells him to hurry, because Emma is going to show them the guest house. Because there was no electricity in the house, Emma lights up a bunch of candles. She said if they needed anything, they could go to the main house. Krug thanked her for her hospitality. Emma returned home and didn't see Mari crawling around. At Emma's house, she says there's something weird about her guests, but John doesn't think much of it. They heard a loud banging outside on the porch. John and Emma went outside to hear the sound of a rocking chair. Then they were shocked to see Mari there. John saw that she had been shot, so he led him into the living room. He heats up the knife in the fireplace and cauterizes the wound to stop the bleeding. He told Emmy to take alcohol and towels from the kitchen. In the kitchen, Emma finds Marissa's necklace wrapped in Justin's cup. She realized who her guests were. Mari is struggling to breathe, so John turned her to the side and cut her on the back. He would then place a tube on the wound so he could breathe. John sees blood in her inner thigh and realizes that she has been raped. Emma tells John that her guests are doing this with her daughter. She saw Mari wearing the necklace before she left, and she knows Justin left it around his cup. John was overwhelmed and Emma asked him what they would do. The nearest house was miles away, they didn't have a car and the gang was still there. John tells her they have to be ready to do anything. Because Mari needed a hospital, they plan to use her boat to travel there. Meanwhile, in the guest house, Sadie takes a shower and Krug gets ready for bed. He saw Justin sleeping on the couch in the next room. It turns out Justin is pretending to be asleep, and he starts to eye Krug's pistol. Sadie slept without a top and slept with Krug. As Francis sleeps in a chair nearby, Justin enters the room and steals Krug's gun. John went to the boathouse and prepared the boat, but found that the keys were missing. When he looked around, he began to look at some tools nearby. He took the hammer as a weapon to kill guests. Emma looked at some kitchen knives, and then Francis suddenly appeared. It is said that lightning outside woke him up and asked her if she had anything to drink. To keep him from seeing the picture of Mari on the fridge, Emma flirts with him and says that John is passed out upstairs. He offers Francis wine and told him to wait in the living room while she takes a glass. Francis enters the other room and sees Mari sitting in front of the fireplace. He recognized her and was almost frightened when Emma hit a bottle of wine on his head. He charges at her angrily, but Emma stabbed him in the chest with a knife. Francis beats her a little and went to the dining room window to try to warn the others in the guest house, but they didn't hear because of the storm. John comes and beats Francis with a hammer. He also broke Francis' nose. They returned to the kitchen during the fight. Emma and John grabbed Francis' head in the sink and drowned him. While thrashing around, Francis' hand winds up in the garbage disposal. John turns and cut Francis's hand. As Francis screamed in pain and tried to escape, John stabbed him in the head with the hammer and killed him. John and Emma enter the guest house, armed with butcher knives and fire poker to kill the others. They approaches the room and sees Krug and Sadie on the bed, but they seize Justin next to him. Justin points a gun at them, but offers it to John. John walked slowly through the room as far as he could and handed the gun. When he cocks it, Sadie wakes up. John shoots her, grazing her neck, but also wakes Krug. Sadie jumps on John and fights him for a gun while Krug throws bed at Emma. John throws Sadie into the bathroom and tries to shoot Krug, but he jumps out the window and goes home. Sadie pulled a rod from the shower and hit John with it, ripping the pistol from his hands. Justin tries to help John, but Sadie pushes him away. Emma took the gun and shot Sadie in the left eye, killing her. Krug arrives at the house, somewhat confused as to why Collingwood is attacking them. Then he looked into the living room and saw blood on the table. She went to the kitchen and found Francis' body. Krug was very angry and upset. It turns out that the Collingwood set Mari on the boat before going to the guest house. Emma stays with her while John goes home with fire poker to kill Krug. John saw his wallet on the table in front of the fireplace. Krug sees a picture of his family and knows that Mari is their daughter. Upstairs, Krug mocks John to come up and get him. Krug rolled onto the floor slightly and kept moving around to throw John off. He looked outside and realized they were about to use the boat to escape. He opened the window and made a loud noise as John roared up. When he thought Krug had escaped from the window, he tried to call Emma. It turns out Krug was hiding in the room. He ambushes John and start fighting brutally together. Krug kicked John on the railing on the stairs, causing him to fall to the ground. Krug then approached the wounded John and asked him if he wanted to know how tied his daughter is. John says he wants to be heard begging for his life and breaks a table over Krug. After another fight, Krug hit John with the fire poker until he passes out. John falls to the floor and Krug is about to stab him when he hears a gun behind him. Krug turned around to see Justin pointing a gun at him. Krug can't believe it, telling him he picked a hell of a time to man up. Krug said he was not angry and asked for a gun. Justin pulled the trigger, but the gun was out of bullets. An enraged Krug stabs Justin in the stomach with a poker fire. Emma returned with the fire extinguisher and hit Krug. She sprayed him with the hose and John hit him with a fiery poker. Emma then knocks Krug to the ground by hitting him in the head with a fire extinguisher. The storm clears up outside. John, Emma, Mari and Justin all get in the boat and drive down the lake. After a while, Krug wakes up alone and finds John standing over him. Krug said he couldn't move. John said he had no rope or tape to hold him, so he injured his whole body to paralyze his neck. Krug asked him helplessly what he was doing. John stuck Krug's head into the broken microwave and turned it on. The film ended with an explosion of Krug's head in the microwave. To watch more explanations of these kinds of movies, click on the videos on your screen and don't forget to let me know how you feel about today's video in the comments down below. Kindly like the video and subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon so you don't miss any new videos. Thanks for watching.